वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग चिल्ड्रेन, दिस इज एल के त्रिपाठी हियर, योर षष्ठी टीचर फ्रॉम एलपीएम पब्लिक स्कूल। डियर चिल्ड्रेन, टुडे वी शैल स्टार्ट द न्यू चैप्टर, दैट इज फ्रॉम हिस्ट्री चैप्टर 9। द टॉपिक इज इमर्जेंस ऑफ रीजनल कल्चर्स। दिस टॉपिक विल गिव अस ए लॉट ऑफ इन्फॉर्मेशन अबाउट द रीजनल कल्चर विच फ्लरिश ड्यूरिंग द मिड सेंचुरी ऑफ द इंडियन हिस्ट्री, एंड सो मेनी थिंग्स विल कम आउट फ्रॉम दिस डिस्कशन। सो इट्स बेटर फॉर अस टू हैव अ डिस्कशन रिलेटेड टू दिस चैप्टर, दैट इज एमरजेंस ऑफ रीजनल कल्चर्स। सो बी अटेंटिव एंड बी कॉन्शियस, लिसन केयरफुली, लेट्स गेट स्टार्टेड। इन कथकली डांस द मेकअप, कॉस्ट्यूम एंड फेस मास्क आर यूनिक, अलॉन्ग विद द फैक्ट दैट ट्रेडिशनली दिस डांस फॉर्म वॉज परफॉर्म्ड बाई मेल आर्टिस्ट, अनलाइक अदर डांस फॉर्म्स विच है डेवलप्ड इन द टेम्पल कोर्टयार्ड, दिस आर डेवलप्ड इन द कोर्ट एंड थिएटर्स विथ स्ट्रांग रूट्स इन मार्शल आर्ट। दिस डांस सिंबोलाइजेस एन इटर्नल फाइट बिटवीन द गुड एंड द इविल। कैन यू थिंक ऑफ एनी अदर डांस फॉर्म विथ सिमिलर फीचर्स? सो दिस इज द पॉइंट ऑफ डिस्कशन, व्हाट द डांस स्टाइल नाउ डेज वी ऑब्जर्व और वी सी इन द मॉडर्न एरा, मॉडर्न हिस्ट्री। सो ऑल द डांस फॉर्म, बेसिकली द रीजनल डांस फॉर्म लाइक कथकली, भरतनाट्यम, कुचिपुड़ी, ऑल द डांस फॉर्म शोज ए काइंड ऑफ प्रेडिक्टेड सीन ऑफ द फाइट विच वॉज फॉट इन द अर्लियर सोसाइटी ऑफ द कंट्री। This is a show of martial art because all these dance form show the fight between good and evil. So how the fight took place those days, this is a kind of expression in the form of dance, in the form of acting. Therefore, this type of dance style is known as the temple dance or court dance. Time to time, it was organized in the courts of the kings. It was a part of the temple which was performed daily by many of the dancers, but one more thing was there, the temple dancers or court dancer who were fond of such types of art and dance, they were totally male. Women did not go to the temple or go to the court to perform the dance. This was purely the male dance. Gradually, with the passage of time, it converted or changed for the female also, who also got practice in the coming time and became a part of male and female. A striking feature of the medieval period in India was the development of several regional languages. Sanskrit and Persian continue to be the longest not only of the upper classes but also in the court. These two languages were very popular those days. First, Sanskrit and Persian. There was very deep assimilation and deep correlation of Persian and Sanskrit language in the Mid Indian society. That's why this was not only the subject of upper class, but also for the other sections of the society. It was, you can say, the languages of the court. The wide use of local languages and dialects by the bhakti saints, as well as royal patronage by many local and regional rulers, added to the evolution of diverse languages in India. Many of the local languages those days and dialects, the bhakti saint who practice in the medieval India started patronage, their languages were patronized by many local regional rulers, and this became the part of the diverse languages in India in the coming time. Moreover, religious and secular texts of medieval India in the different languages reflect the custom, tradition and cultures of the specific regions where they were composed. These writings inform us about the cultural interactions, social activity and trading patterns in a particular region. Now, the growth of old languages, how did this take place? The oldest language of India is Sanskrit. This is known by everyone. Since ancient times, Sanskrit was the main medium of writing and higher learning in our country. During the first half of the medieval period, Sanskrit was patronized by kings in central and south India. The bhakti saint Ramanuja, Madhavacharya and Shankaracharya wrote in Sanskrit. They all wrote their literature, their hymns, epics in this language. This is the oldest literature and language of the country of India, that is Sanskrit. Now, the next, the dialects on Hindu laws and custom were written in Sanskrit. Most Sanskrit words were produced under the patronage of Hindu or Rajput rulers. Some Jaina scholars like Hemchandra Suri also prefer to write in Sanskrit. The Jain religion is very much close to the Hindu religion. So many of the Jain monks also did their literary works in this language, that is Sanskrit. Surprisingly, little attempt was made to translate either Arabic or Persian literature into Sanskrit. And this was very astonished when a little attempt was made to translate either Arabic or Persian literature into Sanskrit. Some languages were there which were translated in Sanskrit, and they were Arabic and Persian literature. One of the few instances was the translation of Yusuf and Zulaikha's love story by Jami. And the most popular and interesting story that was Yusuf and Zulaikha's love story, written by Jami, was translated in Sanskrit also. However, Sanskrit literature, especially the epics Mahabharata and the Ramayana, as well as the Puranas, were frequently translated into regional languages. Kalhadar Rajtarangali, written in the 12th century, was a string of biographies of the kings of Kashmir and was the first royal chronicle in Sanskrit. Kalhadar Rajtarangali, who belonged from Kashmir, it was written during 12th century. This book became very popular those days, and it was the entire string of biographies of the kings of Kashmir and was the first royal chronicles in Sanskrit. First time the royal chronicle in Sanskrit it was written, and the story and lifestyle of the Kashmiri rulers was written in this book. The family histories of the Rajput rulers, such as Prithvi Raj Vijay and Hamir Mahakavya, were written under their patronage. Semi-historical texts known as Prabandhas were also composed during this period. Considered as one of the finest works of the Sanskrit language, Jayadevas Geet Govinda, composed in the 12th century. This is also a very popular book written by Jayadev. The book is Geet Govinda, written in Sanskrit. Describe the relationship between Lord Krishna and Radha. It comprises 12 chapters, each of which is divided into 24 subdivisions or prabandhas. Geet Govinda, written by Jayadeva, is written by him, is a very popular and very interesting book. This book depicted on the relationship between Lord Krishna and Radha. The verses of the Geet Govinda had inspired many choreographies works in Indian classical dance. In the south, the rulers of Vijayanagar, the Nayakas of Tanjore and the chiefs of Travancore and Cochin also extended their patronage to works in Sanskrit. Many genres of Sanskrit, like Mahakavyas, historical Kavyas and dramas, were written during this period. Govinda Dikshita, Appaya Dikshita at the court of Vellore and Nilantha Dikshita at the court of Madurai were some of the important writers of this period. Next, Arabic and Persian. Arabic, the language of the prophet, was not widely used in medieval India, being confined to rulers of the Delhi Sultanate and a small group of Islamic scholars and philosophers. It was the language for digest on Islamic law, like the Fatwa-e Alamgiri. A digest of law written by a group of jurists during the reign of Aurangzeb. However, Persian introduced by the Turks into India became the language of the Islamic courts, administration and the upper classes. It also proved to be the preferred language of many great composers and writers. In this context, mention must be made of Amir Khusro, that is 1252 to 1325 century, one of the most outstanding literary figures of this period, known as the poet of India. He created a new literary style called Sabak-e-Hind, means the style of India. He began his career at the court of Balban and was associated with the court of Delhi Sultanate. A disciple of Nizamuddin Awliya, he was a great poet, historian, scholar, mystic, and composer of music. His famous works include Shirin Khusro, Laila Majnu, etc. Masnavis are narrative poems which are of great historical and literary value, like Kiran, As-Sadan and Tughlaqnama, were also written by him. The Khalik Bari, a dictionary in verse containing 2000 couplets in Hindi, explaining the meaning of Hindi, Persian and Arabic words, was another significant work by Khusro. Cole chronicles were distinct literary genius of the period, and the important works were Futuh-us-Salatin, Futuhat-e-Firozshahi and Tabaqat-e-Nasiri, translation of classical Sanskrit works into Persian, was also undertaken during this period. The Ramayana and the Mahabharata were also translated into Persian during the 15th century. Biographies, autobiographies, and histories were also written throughout the Mughal period in Persian and Turkish. The Babarnama, Tuzuk-e-Jahangiri, Gulbadan Begum's Humayunnama, Abul Fazl's Akbarnama, Badayuni's Padshahnama were some of the significant literary works written during this period. So in this way, we have come to know much more about the Indian languages, the importance of literature and relationship between Arabic, Sanskrit and Persian literatures. So many writers were there during this period who wrote their books according to their own. So that's all. We shall discuss the next in the next video. Thank you.